Cisco FTD NAT configuration is the topic of this section. In the last section, we discussed the concept of different type of NAT and how they are implemented in a Cisco FTD device. In this section, we will implement examples of different types of NAT. In the last section, we introduced different types of NAT just to review with source NAT internal users with private IP addresses connect to the internet. With destination NAT, users from the internet connect to the enterprise servers with private IP addresses. With static and dynamic NAT, there is one-to-one mapping between real address and translated addresses. With PAT, many real addresses will be translated to just one or a few addresses. With policy NAT, we can match the traffic based on both source and destination address and also port numbers. We have also the flexibility to translate the source address, the destination address, or both. With identity NAT, we will exclude some traffic to be translated, especially over VPN tunnels. To review the topology, FTD connects the inside zone with IP address range 192.168.10 to outside zone with IP address range 192.168.1, which has already internet access. To give a configuration example for all these NAT types, I made a table with an example for each NAT type. In continue, we will configure all of these examples one by one. We will configure source NAT and destination NAT by AutoNAT, and we'll configure policy NAT and identity NAT with manual NAT. We will start with static NAT. What we will configure in static NAT is to translate the IP address 192.168.10.11 inside zone to 192.168.1.11 in outside zone. There are 2 points to notice in static NAT. First, static NAT has always higher priority than dynamic NAT or PAT. So if an IP address is matched with both static and dynamic NAT, static NAT has more priority. Second, static NAT is by default bidirectional. That means it works for both source NAT and destination NAT. In our example, not only the IP address 192.168.10.11 is translated to 192.168.1.11 for the traffic from inside to outside zone, but when you access the IP address 192.168.1.11 from outside zone, you will be connected to the inside zone with IP address 192.168.10.11. So now we can start our Cisco FTD NAT configuration. To implement NAT for the first time, we need to create a new policy in devices and NAT. New policy, threat defense NAT for FTD device, NAT policy 1, and we choose FTD device on which we will configure NAT rules, add to policy, and then save. To implement a static NAT, we have to add an auto NAT rule, so add rule, and then auto NAT rule, and then static, the type of NAT. In interface object tab, source interface object is the object containing the real address, and destination interface object is the object containing the translated address. So inside zone is the source interface address and outside zone is mapped to the destination interface object. On the translation tab, original source is an object that points to the real address, and translated source is an object that points to the translated address. Original source object and translated source object can contain more than one address, but the number of addresses must be the same in both objects. We will create an object for original source, which is 192.168, host underline 192.168.10.11. Then save for original source. And the object, we will create a new object, host 192.168.1.11 for the translated address. So the original address or real address 192.168.10.11 will be translated statically to the 192.168.1.11 address, and then okay, and then save, and then apply. To test our configuration, we send ping traffic from the computer behind FTD with address internode with IP address 192.168.10.11, as we can see, to address 888, and we capture the traffic in another computer in the outside interface, TCP dump, ICMP, and host 8888. Deployment is complete, so we can test it. As you can see, the source address is translated to 192.168.1.11 when it's forwarded by FTD to 8888. The IP address from 192.168.10.11 to 1.11 is translated. In the second example, dynamic NAT is the same as static NAT, and there is a one-to-one mapping between real address and translated address. The difference is that the translated address is chosen dynamically from a pool. So we will create two pools, two objects, for one for inside zone, the other for outside zone. Device NAT. Edit, add rule, we choose AutoNAT, and then dynamic NAT. We'll create two objects for original source and translated source. Range 192.168.10.2.5. And then save, and the translated address 1, the range 192.168.1.2, 192.168.1.5, and then save. interface inside zone and outside zone, and then okay, and then save, and then deploy. And deploy. There is no need that the number of address be the same in both objects, but if the number of translated address is less than the number of real address, then all real address cannot be translated at the same time. So let's check it from internal. I change the IP address. From 10.11 to 10.2. We start networking service. And then the IP address is changed to 192.168.10.2. And now I ping 8888 again, but before that, let's enable TCP dump. As you can see, the IP address from 10.2 is translated to 1.4. Is a chosen dynamically from the pool, and now let's change the IP address to another. For example, 10.3. And check it again. Restart networking service. The IP address is now 10.3 and ping again to 8.8.8. And now you can see the IP address translated to 1.3. The previous one to 1.4 and now to 1.3. So dynamic NAT also works. And the next example is PAT configuration example. With PAT, many addresses are mapped to a single or a few address. The single address can be also the IP address of outgoing interface, which I will use in our configuration example. In our example, we'll configure the IP address range 192.168.10.6.2.11 to a single FTD outside interface IP address 192.168.1.101. Notice that the IP address 192.168.10.11 is in both static and PAT rule. I've created this by intention to show you that the static NAT has more priority. Let's check it in device NAT. Add new rule, again auto NAT rule, and dynamic again. The original source will create a new object, range 192.168.10 from 6 to 11. And again, range 6 to 11 will be translated to a single address or outgoing destination interface IP. Destination interface IP is the IP address of outside zone. or we can choose here, for example, the address and a path pool. I can choose instead of address destination interface IP. The both is possible. So, okay. And then save. And then deploy. If I ping, for example, from IP address 6, it will be translated to 101. But if I ping from the IP address 11, it will be matched with the static NAT and will be translated to 111. Let's check it. In the inside, for the first scenario, we will choose the IP address 6. And we ping 888. At the same time, we will monitor the traffic with TCP dump in outside zone. As you can see, the IP address is mapped to the IP address of outside interface 101. But if I change the IP address to 7, again it will be translated to the same address. Since it is path, as you can see, it is translated again to 101. But if I change the IP address of the interface to 11, then we expect that it will be translated to 11. As you can see, it is translated to 11 because static NAT has more priority than dynamic NAT or path rule. For the next example, we'll configure destination NAT or static destination NAT. As it is mentioned earlier, static NAT is by default bidirectional. We have already created a static NAT rule which mapped the IP address 192.168.10.11 to in inside zone to 192.168.1.11 in outside zone. In this example, not only the IP address 10.11 from inside zone is translated to 1.11 in outside zone, but when you access the IP address 1.11 from the outside zone, you will be connected to 192.168.10.11. Let's check it. For example, I ping or tell SSH. From 192.168.1.11, which is the IP address of translated address in static NAT, I'm connected to 10.11. The host with the name 192, 168, 10, 11. So our static NAT works in the both direction. So we don't need to add any extra rule for a static destination NAT. And the next example is destination path rule. In destination path example, I'm going to use the outside interface IP address 1.101 to publish two different services type Zoom. When you access 192.168.1.101 with the port 23 or telnet from outside Zoom, then you will be connected to the server with IP address 1010 to the same port in inside Zoom. And when you access from the outside Zoom with the same IP address but with the port number 22, then you will be connected to server with IP address 1012, the port number 22. Let's configure it. Device NAT. Add rule again, AutoNAT rule, static. Real addresses inside Zoom and translated addresses in outside Zoom. And the object, we have got two objects. One object for 1010. Host 192.168.10.10. 102.168.10.10 and save. With the port 23 and the translated address is the interface outside interface IP address with port 23 and then okay. And another rule again, AutoNAT static new object host 192.168.10.12 with port 22 host 1012 with port 22 and the translated address is the address of outside interface with the port 22. Okay. Destination interface object should be, we have not already selected interface inside and outside. Because of that, we receive an error. And then save. And then deploy. So let's change the IP address of the computer from 1011 to 1012 just to test it. We have also a Windows computer with the IP address 1010. ipconfig. The IP address is 1010, so we will telnet to Windows computer and we will SSH to the Linux machine. So we will start with port 23, telnet, and the IP address of outside interface 1.101. We expect that we are connected to Windows computer. The port 23, as you can see, it is Microsoft Telnet service, And we check it again, this time with port 22. We are connected to the inside Linux machine with the IP address 10.12. The IP address is 10.12, as you can see. So the next example is PolicyNAT configuration example with PolicyNAT, which is implemented by ManualNAT. We have more flexibility to match and translate or not to translate any of source and destination addresses. In ManualNAT, we have the option to configure rules before AutoNAT or after AutoNAT. Let's check it. Add rule. In ManualNAT, we have the option to configure rules before AutoNAT rule or after AutoNAT rule. When ManualNAT rules are configured before AutoNAT rule, then they have more priority than AutoNAT rules and they will be processed before AutoNAT rules. But if ManualNAT rules are configured with after AutoNAT rule, then they have less priority and will be processed if traffic is not matched with any of AutoNAT rules. We will configure ManualNAT rule before AutoNAT rule. In our example, the source IP address 10.11 will be translated to 1.177, but only when the destination of the traffic is 1.111. Otherwise, it will match a static NAT rule, which translates the source IP address 10.11 to IP address 1.11. Let's check it. From inside to the outside with the static host 10.11 original source and original destination 10.111. We don't have, we have to create a new object. Host 192.168.1.111 is the original source and it's the original destination. We also have the option to configure original source port and original destination port, but for our example we will not configure it. And the original source 10.11 will be translated to 1.177. So I create a new object here. Pass 192.168.1.177. And then save. Translated 1.177, but the destination will not be changed to 1.111, and then okay. And then deploy. I will change the IP address of inside computer from 10.12 to 10.11. Restart networking service. And now the IP address is 192.168.10.11 and will ping For the first example, ping 192.168.1.1.1.1. We expect that it will be translated to 177. So I will check it in outside computer, BTCP dump. 192.168.1.1.1.1. And then we'll check from this computer. As you can see, the IP address is translated to 177. But if I ping another IP address with a different destination IP, for example, 8, then it will not be translated to 177. It will be matched with a static NAT and will be translated to 111. So policy NAT also works. And the last example is identity NAT. With identity NAT, we have the option to exclude some traffic from NAT. One application of identity NAT is to be implemented over VPN connections, since traffic over VPN connections does not typically need to be translated. In addition, most VPN technologies are not compatible with NAT technology. Therefore, it happens a lot to implement identity NAT, which excludes some traffic to be translated. In our example, traffic between 192.168 and destination also 192.168 in inside and outside zone are exempt from NAT because they are internal subnets. So we will add a new rule, NAT. Add rule, again manual NAT rule, again before auto NAT rule, a static between inside and outside, and the translation, the original source, we will create a new object with the network net underline 192 underline 168. And save net. The same object will be used also for original destination, and they will not be translated, so we will not change it. We will choose again the same object for both source and destination, and then okay. Save and deploy. I will ping from inside computer 192.168.1.11 to 192.168.1.88, which is another internal computer but in outside zone. At the same time, I will run TCP dump in computer in outside zone, and it is matched with 192.168.1.88. So I can start to ping. As you can see, neither of the source or destination IP address is translated.